I'm Kayla, and this is Nick, and we're the co-chairs for the Innovation in Teaching Conference here at the Mary Frances Early College of Education at the University of Georgia. This year, we chose to shift from our face-to-face conference, in 2020, to a virtual event, sort of, where we had people submit videos for what they did during the pandemic, how they reacted to what happened, and how their teaching had changed due to being sent home in March. Now, today, we wanted to check back in, see where everybody's at almost 2 years later, and see what things are still going on. So we'll hand it over to you guys if you would like to introduce yourselves and then quickly summarize your video.
We'll just start with the way things kind of look on our screen. So Jessica, tell us a little bit about your video and yourself, please.
Okay. My name is Jessica Van Valkenburg. I'm currently an assistant professor at Columbus State University in the teacher education department. During the pandemic, when the pandemic started, I was still teaching K-12. So my video goes over that side of things because I was still in the classroom. Everything was really abrupt. And all of a sudden, during last period, we got a notification, not even formally through the district. It started coming through on students' phones that we were out of school for the next 2 weeks. And then that ended up being we were out of school indefinitely. And I taught eighth grade. So there were a lot of activities and end of year celebrations that we were just not able to do. And honestly, March 13th, 2020 was the last day I saw those students. I never saw them again. We weren't able to tie up any loose ends, and it was very emotional, and still is pretty, you know, disheartening as an educator to not be able to follow through with some of those celebrations. That kind
of
summarizes
your video of all of them, Jessica. I'll say what was the only one that made me tear up. Mm-hmm. And it was really powerful to hear that personal story. So again, thank you so much for submitting that. I'm not sure how to go to the DAG group, so I'm just going to keep going on my screen with Anton. Hi, welcome.
Oh, thank you. Thanks. So, myself, Peter, Bourgeau, and Amanda, we're all from University of Waterloo, which is located in Ontario. We submitted a video. I'm not actually convinced that I should be the one speaking about the video since it was Bourgeau's idea initially. But in short, I mean, we basically, we use this platform, with this platform Mobius. I mean, University of Waterloo has been, or particularly our faculty has been focusing on online education for quite a while now. Peter can correct me if I'm wrong, but it's about a decade now, right? And so we've been using this platform Mobius, which like sort of enables us to create this like rich algorithmic assessment. So it's not just multiple choice. No. Like each question can be essentially a program, for example. And so what we, like in our video, we basically demonstrated how you can build like with Mobius these very rich textbooks, which enable students to get immediate feedback, get some time on certain questions, which enable them to take assessments, which enable them to see some kind of interaction with the material that they're learning, you know, like actually like rotate 3D graphs or anything like, things like that. I think we submitted for, so correct me if I'm wrong, so this was a proofs course, like introduction to proofs, calculus 3. We have applied, I think it was one differential equations course and something else. I don't remember.
Geometry one, I believe.
Linear algebra.
Yeah, there we go. Linear algebra. There we go. So I think it was 4 in total.
Does anyone else from the group want to add?
Yeah, maybe I can just add a couple of things. So I'm Peter Wood. I am the assistant dean for online education and lifelong learning, and I foolishly agreed to take on this role 6 months before the pandemic. They said, do you want to do this online? I thought, oh, that's a nice little portfolio. Yeah. I can kind of work quietly in my corner. And then suddenly everything is online. And it's been quite a ride. The faculty, we had the advantage here is the Digital Assets Group was not formed as a COVID response. It actually was formed really about 6 months before the pandemic, because the faculty did have an online presence and we wanted and they were fine. Like, we had good courses, but we wanted better than good. So we thought if we get a dedicated group of people, we could build really high quality assets. And I think everybody in the room knows how hard it is to build really good engaging online stuff. It takes a lot of effort. So this group was assembled to be able to spend that time. And we were able to spend that time. But then when the pandemic hit, it became more of a panic helping lots of other instructors. And I think we pointed this out in the video that because of the modular design, we teach like 18 different linear algebra courses to science and engineering and all these different groups. And same with calculus, that now we can grab the pieces that make sense and very quickly assemble, you know, a perfectly good version, another version for a different audience. That worked out. We're very lucky that way. That worked out well for us. And the thing, teaching mathematics is a very active, you have to do it. You can't just sort of sit there and watch somebody else do the math. That's active learning is very important. And that's hard to do online, right? I mean, in a class, you can point at a student and say, okay, you know, is this right? Or what do you think we do next? It's, you get that dialogue. But online, that's just totally different environment. And sort of Jessica's comment about when you don't see the students anymore, it's completely different.
Yeah.
So that's what we really tried to leverage with our Mobius system, is the concept of active learning. You ask questions, students can give answers and get feedback. And that's a huge chunk of our sort of design philosophy. And as much as possible, we were able to share that with other instructors teaching other classes. So, I mean, some of it was good fortune, not so much good planning on our part, but
we couldn't have predicted this, but you guys certainly seemed pretty well positioned going into that. And the pieces of the courses that we could see in the video really did look slick and beautiful. I think as we kind of go through a little bit more, you know, we'll talk about how that situated in the pandemic, because I'm sure there were still some stress points in the scaling of it all. But Aaron, tell us a little bit about your video and yourself, please. Did we lose Aaron? Is he frozen? He looks a little frozen to me.
Or we are, at least.
Yeah. Oh, what should we do?
Oh,
here we go.
Okay, yep. Pick him back.
Oh, you disappeared. You're on mute there, but there you came back. Okay. No, you're still muted. You're still muted. We can't hear you.
I mean, it's displaying that their microphone is on though, which is interesting.
Hey, can you hear us now?
What's up?
Yes.
Yes.
There are always some technical glitches, right? You just don't want them in the pandemic. Aaron, I was tossing the baton to you. To tell us a little bit about yourself and your video submission.
Sure. My name is Aaron Gearhart. I'm also, like Jessica, an assistant professor at Columbus State in Columbus, Georgia. We both joined the faculty to start the 2021 academic year. Jessica mentioned the date of March 13th, 2020. That's the day I also received the phone call that my school district in Northwestern Illinois was closing due to the pandemic. I was teaching third grade at the time before I made the move down here to Columbus. My wife worked at the same school as me. She was a music teacher, but we weren't at school that day. We were in the hospital because my daughter Ramona was born on March 13th. And we got the call that day that the schools were closing down. We had already resigned from our positions effective at the end of that year, and we were planning to move to Georgia. So life became quite complicated that day. We're able to successfully make the move. She found another music teaching position here in the Columbus School District. And most of my video talked about that journey and then meeting my students. At the time, we allowed students to opt into face-to-face instruction or virtual learning. I taught an elementary science methods course that first semester. I had about 30% virtual who would log on live, kind of like what we're doing now, and then 70% in the room. And so my video focused a lot on kind of like what Peter spoke to earlier about active and participatory learning, regardless of the mode of attendance, and me trying to find different course design and activity approaches to make sure my students were all equitably and actively participating and developing pedagogical content knowledge to prepare them to teach in the K-5 classroom level. So that's kind of what I guess my focus was.
That was excellent. Yours, you know, I have a little fact about me before being here. I ran a film festival here in Athens, Georgia, and your story, the move, the baby, the all of it, it just really was like watching a short film. You would have been accepted into my festival right away. Excellent. I'm glad it all turned out okay.
Yeah.
Let's see. So, Anne, tell us a little bit about your video and your submission and yourself, please.
Sure. Well, I'm Anne Lindsay, and I am one of the Marine Education faculty and the Associate Director for the Marine Education Center and Aquarium, which is a part of the University of Georgia, part of Marine Extension and Georgia Sea Grant. And we're actually located on the coast on Skidaway. And we're in the field trip business, for lack of a more complicated way to explain it. And like everyone else, on March 13th, our world changed quite a bit. Our video is about the process that our education team of 6 full-time senior educators and 4 education fellows went through to take over 30 different field, laboratory, exploratory, outdoor, hands-on, feed-in kind of programs and turn those into a series of 15 virtual school programs. And we did that with the help and the inspiration of one of our longtime visiting groups who said, "We still want to work with you on November 5th. What can you do for us?" And so from about August to November of 2020, we worked on that process and learned a lot of new things, all of which I'm sure many of you are experts in, but we were not and still aren't. And so my video is about that process, the decisions that we made, the challenges that we, you know, had in learning a whole new language and way to teach. We had done distance learning for a long time at this facility, but not with the new tools and certainly not under the conditions of a pandemic. And then I hope that our video was ended with a hopeful note that even though we were serving 40 kids who are from the Atlanta area with the pilot programs, we now are able to reach some groups of underserved students and communities and experiences that we weren't able to before. And so, you know, a commitment to the process has made us a more versatile organization. So we're grateful for that.
I really would say it ended with a hopeful note. I mean, a few things that I thought sort of teased out of your video really nicely. I mean, one, to be in the experiential side of education and having to make that pivot, you know, it sounds like you really learned a lot of new things that may really alter the direction. I mean, so, you know, we can break that all apart because I think Jessica in her video mentions an equity issue around Chromebooks, and I hear that in yours too. So why don't we start right there? I mean, because I think in some ways that taps in to what everybody was sort of doing, that they found a way that they could kind of reach their audiences. Our DAG group, again, had made that decision 6 months before, it sounds like, but I'm sure there was still a lot of sort of tinkering on the margins and then everybody having to go that way. I'm sure there was some struggle there. So let's start with Anne. So Anne, what in your video, one of the pieces that made me smile really big was you said you found some superstars, some rock stars on your team. And so how have you repositioned them? How is that changing the dynamic of your group?
Well, that's a great question. I mean, a lot has changed in the year since then, and some of those folks have moved on from our organization, and so we are a leaner organization, not by choice, in terms of the number of folks that we still have on site to teach. I think that, to be honest with you, I think that we all felt that once we had created that series of programs, that they were as awesome as we could make them. And they were awesome because there were some fearless people in our group who just said, let's learn how to do it. Come on, old people. I'm one of the old people. And, you know, and we did it. And there were some tears in back rooms that we won't talk about. But, and I think we all acknowledged by the spring of 2021 that those were useful programs, but we were having a hard time using them. Mm-hmm. And where we thought the floodgates would open and everybody would say, oh yes, please, you know, let us hook up with you. Let us, you know, schedule a virtual program. That's perfect until we can get to the coast. That hasn't been the case.
I love your honesty. That's great.
And so what we find now is that, you know, we have it in our back pocket. We are offering it to any group who calls us and then calls us back and says, I'm sorry, we can't come. But we haven't had many takers on it. Mm-hmm. So I don't think any of us feel that it was not worth the effort, but it's going to take some development and it's going to take some marketing and it's going to take some re-envisioning it as potentially part of grant proposals that allow us to continue to meet the needs of kids who can't get here to the coast. So I don't know if that answers your question, but.
It's so honest. And I think it really, you know, first of all, it addresses what I think all of us have seen. So, you know, did they not come because it wasn't interesting? I doubt that. Or have we all been in a really stressful place for a while? And so taking on new things is even extra daunting. That would be, you know, or figuring out how does this fit into what I do. But it sounds like you have some really good work to do in the future and some new avenues to go down. And you know, they always say necessity is the mother of invention. But in our case, it's the mother of innovation as well in making those pivots.
Yeah, and I think too, you know, all of you talked about transitioning into an online environment for something that was better in some ways face-to-face. So that was an interesting connection between you all. And like you're sort of saying too, I mean, there's some value in going and being in there, being in the water and actually physically having that field experience. So for you, it might have been what was useful in the moment. And now you're shifting back to find the value of face-to-face instruction. Whereas in some of our other groups, here, you know, there may have been something you learned where you realized that you could mirror what you did in the classroom online and then be able to open up your classroom to be more equitable to more groups.
I apologize if I say your name right, but Bursu, am I close to right?
Very close, Burju. Oh,
Burju. Yes. Again, thank you so much for submitting your video. Tell us a little bit about the pressure points in the rapid scale up, because that's what, as I watched it, I just sort of went, wow, they weren't expecting the rush at the gates here.
Not at all, but I'm glad we were prepared because we were structurally changing the way we teach our online courses. We were switching from all videos to this interactive textbook approach. Correct me if I'm wrong, Peter, but so we were all really excited about our interactive textbook because it was also part of an affordable education approach, mm-hmm. right? When I was an undergrad student, I was never able to afford a textbook.
Yeah.
So all I had was the lecture notes from my professors. I became friends and I had a textbook for the first time when I was a grad student. And I was like, oh, this was a fortune to me. And then when I started teaching, I started realizing what textbooks can offer.
Yeah.
So our courseware comes with an interactive textbook. And now we're able to offer this interactive textbook, not to only online students, but students on campus are also being offered. Like, hey, instructors, if you're teaching this course, you can take this interactive textbook. It's accompanying pieces. And all the students can have an interactive textbook experience on a very limited budget. And So it was really exciting in terms of the volume. So our faculty has decided to combine all the sections together and assign a number of instructors, and having the textbook ready, like my textbook was not fully ready, but it was mostly developed. I was able to spend some time completing the future units, but I had enough time to work with other instructors, create other activities that would increase student engagement. So having the textbook ready and knowing that students are already interacting with the textbook, knowing that initial learning is already happening, we had time to spend with our students to discuss the topics and how do different concepts are related to each other, how we can have maybe a problem solving session, or we can have like more casual conversations about what calculus is about, how do we make those connections. So it was a really a rewarding experience. In terms of the volumes, we did try team teaching, and we did enjoy it very much. We were all skeptical about, okay, I was in charge of my own section hall this time. Now I have the 600 students and four people are, but it was really awesome that we were able to come up with a reasonable workload for everyone, because we were taking turns doing things and we were meeting on a weekly basis to discuss what's going to happen that week. And it was amazing to exchange ideas with other instructors on how to approach, you know, how to, you know, teaching this course from different perspectives. So it was a very rewarding experience. There were times, tears and cries, but it was sure. All worth it at the end. Very, very rewarding experience.
It's really exciting. So Amanda, why don't you pick up on that a little bit with the idea of what were the sort of surprises? You know, what was really working or not really working? And because I'm hearing a little bit of, we were building a plane while it was flying. Oh, we're having trouble hearing you.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, yes. Perfect.
Okay, yes. Yeah, I was going to say that analogy is very appropriate. So to give you a sense of like how much of the plane was built, So Virju was teaching the calculus in the spring, like the spring term was kind of the first fully online. I think we were done about fully done like 5 out of 15 units. So we were like maybe a week or two ahead of students at all times. And we really had to, you know, like downgrade certain things. So like maybe our videos were not the best quality, but we're just like a low fidelity prototype. And then we were able later to kind of go back and put those pieces in, but it was definitely cutting it close.
Yeah. You weren't alone in that feeling.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, sorry. So that was the, and I guess the other thing that I think is worth mentioning in like, if we're thinking about like equity and how we're rethinking all these things, one of the nice things that we can do with Mobius and the way that the interactive textbook is set up is really rethink our assessment structure. Mm-hmm. Because sort of pre-pandemic, it was very common for students to have one midterm, maybe like 30%, one final exam, 70%. And, you know, we don't have proctored exams anymore. We can't do that. So we are switching to sort of more frequent low stakes assessments.
Love that.
Yeah, and we're finding like students, I think, are appreciating it. We get a lot of student comments, at least for the calculus course, like, thank you so much for not having a midterm. Right? Like, we already have so much to do at that time of year. Like, we're so busy. Thank you for not doing that. And we got a lot of positive student comments about feeling like it was a healthy learning environment. And I think that also had to do with the way that the assessment structure was set up, that they don't feel like they're putting all their eggs in one basket. And again, we've been playing a little bit around with the assignment settings. So the way that we had it in spring, we gave them unlimited attempts on their assignments.
Great.
So you'll get like the same kind of underlying questions, but the numbers will change. Mm-hmm. But you can basically go in and try it and like do it until you are happy with with your result. And like, that's a nice way as well for them to get comfortable with you know, learning and failing and knowing that that's not going to affect kind of the bottom line, which they worry a lot about, of course.
Wow, that hits a lot of buttons for me. I mean, again, we do, but I teach a course on games culture and human development. And one of the things I try to tell my students, they're all doc students and they're going to use a game or work a game in their study. But it is that importance of failure, right? That lowering the stakes. So again, you said a lot of the things, and we're following James Lang's work on ungrading right now. And so I think there's a lot of great stuff about how we get deeper student engagement as we lower some of those stakes and make learning a little less punitive. And so I'm excited that sort of is coming out of the work you guys are doing. Jessica, let me come back to you again. I don't know if you guys heard this at the very beginning. I told Jessica her video was the only one that really made me tear up as I watched it. And so how are you doing now? What's it look like where you are now?
Doing well. The transition from K-12 to higher ed was a little, I guess, less stressful, mainly because I saw a lot of the same challenges in terms of, you know, students that didn't have access, students that needed to, you know, come to class virtually. I had to learn the technology because it was my first semester. So we were kind of in it together, which I think created a bond in a lot of ways with my students. And I did a lot of work just trying to lower the stakes and work with my students and make sure that they knew that I could be flexible. I had never done this before. They didn't know that. But,
right.
You know, just working with them and, okay, you can't make it to class, you're sick, whatever, we'll work it out. So there was a lot of flexibility on everybody's part, which I had brought with me from K-12 when school shut down, and all of a sudden I'm making a bunch of copies and setting them outside for people to pick up, or answering student emails when they're trying to do a worksheet, but yet I haven't seen them in weeks. Or, I mean, so just a lot of flexibility and a lot of understanding, something that we're still doing, you know, being flexible with students and trying to make sure that they understand, you know, life isn't exactly what it was 2 or 3 years ago at the moment. It's still not back to normal. So we're having to be flexible with our students and with our teaching to make sure that, you know, everyone is learning and gaining what they need to be from the courses.
You seem to have an epiphany in your video about the equity issue around making those little packets and the number of Chromebooks that could come out. It really struck me because we hear about it a lot, but that it's such a great example of that. In fact, I've shared it with a few other people, and I'm just wondering, is that something that you're thinking about more or passing on to your new students? Is there?
I am. I teach science methods as well. I teach it for middle school. I'm middle grades. And that's something that I have worked into all of my courses, even my graduate level courses and my doc courses, you know, that we have to think about everyone. And we have to make sure that we understand that some students, regardless of age, I mean, adults in our own courses may not have access or may have limited access for a variety of reasons.
Yeah.
And that's something that we have to think about, not only when we're instructing, but also when we're, you know, assigning different assignments.
It's interesting you bring up the connection between your K-12 students and your college students. So I also teach science methods. So I'm actually teaching them that's like K-8, which is weird because I have some that want to be elementary and some that want to be middle. But with the university, they wanted us to go full speed back to normal. I mean, what is that anymore? And it's been interesting because I've been trying to be, you know, very vulnerable and honest and understanding with my students. And it's been a conflict for some professors because they expect something from their college students that they wouldn't normally expect from K-12, because they have this expectation that they're adults and that their world hasn't shifted and they should be able to be accountable. And it's interesting because I feel like I am a K-12 teacher right now. They need me to be that person and be understanding and open and welcoming. And it's been great in a methods course because I can also model to them how they should behave in the classroom. You know, I keep finding myself saying, you know, just in case this happens to you, you might have to teach hybrid. You might have to transition everything online. You know, like we don't know what it's going to look like moving forward. So it's been a really interesting transition. And I feel like your experience in K-12 definitely sounds like helps push you into this new role really well.
I think it did. And I think it has helped. And I think it will continue to help because, you know, I don't know how the schools are up there, but I know down here, some of the schools, when students get sent home, they do go to class virtually still. So they're still having a somewhat hybrid model. So our teachers in their field experience, our candidates in the field experiences are having to experience that.
It's
definitely something they have to learn.
Mm-hmm. Interesting in the sort of diversity of videos that we received, you know, even in this group, we have two that were kind of really personal stories and two that were more sort of institutional. And I really like that because I think it gave us a sort of deeper feel across the dynamic range of what we were all experiencing. So, you know, if I flip that a little bit and Aaron, I'll sort of toss it to you. Were there some, as you were making that move, was there some real institutional differences from Illinois coming down to Georgia?
I guess like what I didn't know any differently. Like, so I had taught at the higher ed level in an adjunct role at Illinois State for about 3 years while I was working on my doctoral degree there. And so I guess in that regard, I was more or less learning new state learning standards and kind of how did the certification process was similar and different here. But for me, it wasn't as big of a concern because I kind of relied on colleagues like, hey, I don't know about this. How do we do this here? For me, it was more about like, it was interesting that first class because they kind of come in, whether they were virtual or face-to-face, very wide-eyed and just, you know, we went through all of this stuff in the spring, now what? And I'm also trying to make sense of it. As I shared in my video, you know, my family had gone through a lot of transition up to that point. So I remember specifically, I don't know if I mentioned in my video or not, but I remember one day, you know, we were talking about like lab activities or something. And I was like, you know, if it wasn't for the pandemic, this is the type of activity I would have planned for us today. And we would have done this and then reflected on this. And then I stopped myself and I took a pause and I said, you know, I think that's the last time I'm going to apologize for the pandemic.
You did say that in the video. I like that.
Did I? Okay. I couldn't remember if it or not. But I said, this is the situation that I'm teaching. I got like very metacognitive with my teaching. And I think that a teacher education course was a perfect venue for that. But I would tell them like, here's what I'm thinking. Here's what I want you to get out of this. Are there any things you need to adjust so that it works for you? But like, I just stopped myself that day and I said, I'm not going to apologize anymore for the pandemic. I didn't cause it. It is what it is. How can we put our best foot forward as educators henceforth? And like, I felt like from that day forward, we had more like open, honest, and frank conversations where it was like, hey, this is what it is. I've got some people on the computer. I've got some people in the room with me. What am I going to do to make sure everyone can participate and construct active meaning through science inquiry in a meaningful and authentic way? And I think, you know, I've had the chance to collaborate with Jessica a lot because I teach the elementary science methods course. She's middle grade. So we've tried to explore just different teaching approaches in our courses that can kind of lend itself towards those efforts. We've done some student narrative podcasting work. This most recent semester, we were able to purchase some Lego education kits. So they've done some design process work. Jessica, you can fill in if I'm missing anything. Those are kind of two of our more recent pieces we've done. I worked with one of our College of Fine Arts faculty members who curates we have like a street gallery here on our River Park campus at Columbus State. And they created short comic strip narratives about elementary learners' experiences in the pandemic. And they were put in a street gallery for the public to see. this past spring, and now they've been installed downstairs at the campus building where I'm sitting right now. So just trying to find ways to still push forward with effective pedagogy and instructional design while also remaining authentic to like the reality of the world we're teaching in now. Because I don't think the approaches we were using before in teacher education are preparing them for a world and context that do not exist anymore. Maybe they'll come back. I kind of doubt it. I think it's backwards to say we're going back to normal. I think it's, there was talk, you mentioned the idea of innovation through constraints earlier. And I think that that's hopefully what we're all aiming towards at this point.
Are you guys still teaching hybrid now?
Only if a student has to be out because they've self-reported for quarantining purposes. We'll Zoom. I would say, so I teach an undergraduate course that has 26 students in it right now. And I would say every week I've got at least somebody home not feeling well. So I'm Zooming in still, but not to the extent where they can opt out if they want to or not. It's more that type of thing, kind of as needed now.
And I will say that something that Aaron mentioned made me think of this, that teaching science methods right now, I did a lot of the same thing last year. I would apologize for not being able to, you know, use a certain example or for us to do a certain activity. But then I found that my students that were in the field were having to be really creative with their activities because of the restrictions the school districts had on students sitting together and using the same materials and manipulatives. So even now I have found that when I give examples and when we do things in class, we do it multiple ways. Okay, here's how you could do this in a traditional face-to-face classroom. How can we differentiate this first this scenario and this scenario? So I think in a lot of ways, it's forcing our candidates to think outside of the box and really help them with their creativity.
You know, what's neat about that is I talk to our faculty a lot about the power of student choice. And so it seems like this really lends itself well that again, because of this situation, you've now created these choices that I completely agree with Aaron in that, as people tell me, when are we returning to normal? I don't know if that happens. And in fact, I hear people say that the new normal, and I keep going, well, I don't even know if I'll feel that. Maybe it's just call it the new. And it just is a series of new news, right? One after another. Because we're now an international conference due to our Canadian friends joining us today, I want to ask that question about institutional constraints versus faculty freedoms. Is there, and you know, if this is a dangerous conversation, you can just give me the high sign, but let me know, tell us a little bit about what happened up north.
I'm not sure who wants to
try
that one. Anne made a comment about some faculty members getting really excited about some technology. Let's give it a try. As I'm sure you know, there are some people who are just that type. They like new things. They want to try it out, and others, not so much. And so you have like a team teaching approach or something like that, where individuals are less comfortable with the technology. It does create significant problems, actually. And the Mobius tool we're talking about, we're saying all these wonderful things about it because when it works well, it works really well. But it is not a friendly tool. Yeah. And there are many people who are literally thrown in the deep end.
On the building side or on the user side?
Mainly on the building side. So the content wasn't exactly what they needed. So things had to be built quickly. They had zero training or 10 minutes of training. And that's just not enough. It just isn't anywhere near enough. And they just didn't have that type of personality to go figure things out. And there were struggles that way, and I think we're still suffering from that, to be honest with you.
Sometimes suffering is learning, you know. I heard a phrase recently, to be your mentor, I must be your tormentor for a bit.
We did a lot of tormenting. part of my role as assistant dean online is people are constantly coming to me with all, like, literally it's a fire hose of technology options, right? It's just too many.
Yes.
And a lot of them, I think, I'm not even going to mention this to anyone. Now that I've seen it, I'm not going to tell anybody about this because it's going to cause more problems than it's going to solve.
Yeah.
When we support faculty too with using technology. So right when we shifted it, like we were, I mean, everyone was emailing us like, do you have an instructional set for doing this? And we're like, no, because it didn't exist, but we'll create it. And so we, you know, our approach in the very beginning was staying afloat. So it was survival. If you can use email, use email. If you, like, we were like, get through the end of the semester and we'll figure it out. And then it's been interesting shifting over time. So we started stay afloat, tread water. And then it was learn how to swim and try to be more innovative and we would help give them more tools. But we definitely did it on a level based on people's excitement and their experience with tech before.
Yeah, our structure in the College of Education is quite different than it is at the broader university. So, I mean, I've worked here for 20 years. And so you really not only know the faculty, you know, who will retire soon, but you also meet the new faculty as they come in. And so one of those pieces has really been trying to interconnect those faculty within departments. I mean, we're very siloed and especially during the pandemic, getting faculty even in the same program or department to connect with one another was strangely difficult. It shouldn't be that hard. But I think some of the trial by fire that we're talking about really did lead to some new friendships. And I'm excited to see, you know, I'm pretty Pollyannish in general, but I'm pretty excited to see what kind of comes out of this next, especially from the students, because I think the thing we're not talking about as we talk about what they've lost and what they missed out on for being in the classroom, but we may have just created a whole new generation of self-directed learners. And that's going to be exciting to watch grow up and become something big. So I'm expecting a new renaissance, you know, but again, I dream big. That's my job around here.
Jessica made a comment about the, you know, flexibility and things like that. And Merzu and Amanda, when they were teaching the multivariable calculus course, I don't know if you can talk about this and give more detail, but became much more flexible with deadlines. Historically, a deadline is a deadline. If you're 2 minutes late, it's over, you know. Yeah. And then because of the pandemic, people became more aware of just general stresses that are around everywhere. And, you know, just that's how can we be flexible or how can we get rid of these rigid rules that appear to be nothing but rigid rules? You know, they don't seem to advance learning. They're just rules.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, maybe they can say something about their experience, but that worked. Like it helped reduce stress for students. And it's not as though all the students just took advantage of every single opportunity to hand things late and didn't do the work. That's not what happened. It didn't seem to affect learning in a negative way. And that's something that could persist. There's no reason why. Look, this is a successful way of operating a class, even when we are back to whatever the new normal looks like.
That's right.
And the question is, how do you let other faculty members know about this? I mean, our digital assets group, we connect regularly. Like our group, we're a pretty close-knit group. We can talk a lot. But that's just us. I mean, it's not much good if we discover something really effective and share it amongst the four of us.
Right.
Like we need, I don't know, maybe that's your expertise. How do you get this out?
Yeah. I mean, so I don't know which of you knew about our conference, but that is exactly what our conference is set up to do. So we do have a traditional keynote, but I think the real special sauce in what we do are 10 to 15 minute small group presentations on whatever you've done that's innovative. It's very open and very inclusive. And you sort of pick and choose from a gigantic menu of about 150 different small talks to go and engage in. They happen very fast, but it throws a lot out there. And then through the program, we have generally everybody shares their email. So there's quite a bit of follow-up. You know, what's been neat about this is the goal has always been to kind of create a community like you're talking about, Peter. And I didn't know if we had done that, but what I've discovered is we actually have. It's smaller than I want it to be, kind of going off where Anne was and saying, you know, I want everybody to jump in this. But but it's growing. And I think it's the right, you know, it's just the right place. So we are excited that we'll go back to, hopefully go back to a live conference next year. And I guess I'll just take this opportunity to say, we're gonna, you know, give comp registrations to all of you guys that sent in a video, and so, you know, you're all welcome here. We'll show you what real Southern hospitality looks like. maybe you'll even eat a fried green tomato. Who knows?
Bridgie, were you gonna say something earlier? I feel like you.
Yeah, I wanted to echo on Peter's point on the use of technology from a student perspective. Put yourself in a student's shoes. You're taking now an online course. It's actually previously on taking an online course was a choice, but now during pandemic, everyone has to take online courses. Now students find themselves taking 5-6 online courses at the same time. And imagine each course is coming with like 4 or 5 different pieces of technology. As a student, you also need to learn to use this technology to benefit and to support your learning. So intentional use of technology was a big topic among us. Like our course comes with 4 different pieces of technology for the purpose of teaching, delivering content, assessment, and evaluation and discussion. So those choices were made really intentional. And whenever we receive a new piece of teaching technology, we were really mindful about integrating that to our teaching. Our Center for Teaching Excellence is also evaluating these teaching tools on a regular basis. And we prefer to use the pieces of technologies that meet certain criteria. So in terms of students also receiving a consistent education through the channels that they are familiar of, that was also a very intentional choices where we made as at least as a faculty of mathematics.
That's exciting. So we have a Center for Teaching and Learning. It sounds a little similar. Are you guys the pioneers of this at Waterloo, or is it are other groups building similar? Because what I saw in the work, it's just the word that comes to mind is cohesive, right? I mean, there was really a common look and feel, and I just love the modular quality of it. So are you guys contagious?
An institutional level, Peter has more experience. Maybe I can pass it on to you, but we do have a center for extended learning. They support course development, online course development for online education. And we do also have Center for Teaching Excellence that serves the entire campus for both online and on-campus teaching. To my knowledge, we are unique in our position in our faculty, a subgroup of lecturers in the math undergrad group who are solely focused on online digital, like digital assets creation, not only for maybe online courses, but it's our and products can also be used to support on-campus teaching as well.
Our group is unique. We have this concentrated digital assets group, but I am hoping our philosophies are contagious.
Yeah, I hope so too.
Yeah, so we do try to evangelize whenever we have the opportunity and show off what we do. And I think it is sticking in other departments. Other faculties are seeing the benefit of what we're doing. The modular type, the interactive type, that active learning.
Yeah.
And, but I say most people are still in COVID crisis mode. I think once we get out of that and people can calm down a little, I'm optimistic. I think you have to maintain it. Be optimistic in these jobs that we can have a positive effect.
Definitely. You guys should feel really comfortable in bragging about what you've built. And you beat us all. You were the one doing active learning before it was cool. So in your world as of today, you know, the policies, what we see here with the K-12 schools, it's still really a school by school kind of decision. It is what I hear from our teacher prep folks. And so are you getting some in-person visits again, or are you leaning on your digital assets? Because we know some people who are really good at building this stuff.
Well,
you know, we're excited that we have four visiting groups between now and the end of the year. Our spring calendar looks pretty good, but it's all sort of a work in progress.
Yeah.
And I think we've agreed as a staff to offer the virtual alternative for any group who would like to do that. But I think we're hoping for a more normal sort of spring.
Yeah.
Did you have any, there is mention of sort of an adaptation for students to learn the technology. So when you delivered your online program, did you find that you had to teach the users how to use the tech?
We had to teach some of the teachers how to use the tech. We had a pretty simple setup. We just used Zoom and some web cameras and some things that we had here on site. I think the trickiest part for us was actually going into the field with a Wi-Fi hotspot and making sure that was working. I mean, not everybody had taught in an online format. Some people had, so there was a learning curve for some folks on, you know, what Jessica was talking about before. Well, I can see the teacher, but I can't see the kids. And so, you know, if it's a 45-minute class, we planned for 35 minutes of instruction. Yeah. In reality, it wasn't always 30 minutes of instruction. And some of it was used with, you know, just the back and forth of communicating through the online platform. When we brought microscope technology or on the boat technology, things that we would do in person with kids in terms of like sorting fish or dissecting a squid or observing a dish of animals underneath the microscope, I think the thing that impressed us was that the excitement that is our currency in the field of work that I do was there.
Yeah.
We couldn't absorb as much of it as we would have liked. But we did our very, very best to try and pay excitement and enthusiasm and, you know, our skills as teachers to connect, to try and fill in the gaps.
You know, I mentioned I ran the film festival. So, and when they release a new movie, we've all seen the trailers that they show before a film of upcoming films. But there's actually a little shorter piece you put out. It's called a teaser. And what some of your digital assets, I think, really make for great teasers that will make people want to come down to Skidaway and experience that firsthand. So, again, I think your parts will all play really nice together.
Absolutely. In fact, we have plans to use our 360 camera. We've used it a number of times already just to do short social media pieces.
Yeah.
We've used it for student onboarding when we brought a new group of young educators on this fall. And so the web-based resources and the grant projects that we were sort of in the midst of when the pandemic hit and also had to pivot. Those are all useful tools and opportunities that wouldn't have happened had we, you know, not been forced indoors on March 13th. So there's more to build on. And certainly there is no going back in terms of how to promote our programs. There's a whole new different way to do it.
Yeah,
and luckily we have some of those young, innovative, you know, fearless people in our communications department who are helping us do that as well.
It's awesome. It's awesome. Sometimes, you know, there's stuff right in front of us that we don't see unless a situation kind of forces us to. Well, Anton, I can tell you're our quiet guy in the group. So I just want to, what do you want to keep from what we've been through in this experience? Like, what's something that's going to stick?
Well, that's a great question. Actually, I'm teaching on campus right now, and so I am already using.
I can tell by your decorative background.
Yes, very innovative. So, personally, what I'm keeping is, we decided to keep this component of, say, Mobius assessments, this Mobius quizzes that we have. They're used in other courses as well as that it's being taught on campus right now. So works like a charm. So one thing that I really like is I personally like to teach online synchronously. I use much more fun backgrounds for that, you know. The attendance was actually pretty good. I was happy with it, you know, and I'm recording as I'm speaking, and I very much liked to write on my tablet, and I'm using that right now in classroom as well. So because on the tablet, it's just so great that you can, like, I don't know, turn on the projector and there's just so many colors and that you can use, so that's just wonderful. It's very easy to record the video because you're just recording the video of your iPad screen. You're posting the lecture immediately after, you post your notes immediately after. So things like that work amazing. And of course, another thing that is very important that I try to do with my students now is I remind them constantly how important that they read ahead. Mm-hmm. I think that they all now understand the value of it coming from this online self-driven education. Yeah. Okay. And so, maybe it's just wishful thinking, but I think that I see this, you know, especially when you're just ingrained them in their brains. If you didn't read ahead, you may be behind, you really want to review it. You know, I left this exercise for you last lecture. We're going to come back to it now, and we're going to do it. We're going to do it again. If you didn't do it last time, now we're going to do it now. Okay.
Yeah.
So, those are the things that I personally kept and am planning to use in the future.
That's awesome. One of the ones I'll brag on Kayla a little bit. She taught a hybrid class in all of this. And again, I think it changed the way you sort of thought about teaching hybrid.
Yeah. You know, it was probably the most challenging teaching experience I've ever been through. And I've taught middle school. So, but, you know, at first it was challenging and overwhelming because I felt like a failure in some ways that I couldn't connect with the students online as much. So the students that were face to face, we had formed this really interesting bond together. We had all gotten vaccinated around the same time. So we were talking about that and like all our symptoms and sharing like when they had to suddenly not be in the classroom because they were quarantining to see family. So it was interesting because we had just by nature of the communication and the time, we had this really strong bond that I missed with my students online, but it opened my eyes to equity. So some of my students chose to come online, not because they felt unsafe about the virus, but because they couldn't afford a parking pass. And UGA had changed some of our bus routes and someone where they lived and they couldn't get out of their lease then, like their bus no longer came. And so it was great for them to have access. And I had offered to make little packets. So we did, like I do an activity where they build a DNA model. And I offered to drop them off or to have them pick them up. But I had the students that were online went and bought their own supplies and then would do it on the camera. I also figured out a cool way to hold my phone. So because the tech in the classroom wouldn't reach everybody. And so I would join Zoom from my phone and then film the students in the classroom doing the hands-on activity that they could see. So it opened up, I think, like to kind of go back to this equity concept, but you know, it provided an opportunity for students to participate in learning and not miss out on that. But they also were able to quarantine if they needed to and be there for their families, stay home and reduce some of the financial burden of coming to campus. And so it's been interesting now transitioning back almost fully face-to-face. And like Aaron said, even when people attend hybrid, it's very similar here. It's because they're quarantining and usually their cameras are off. And so I'm not as attentive with them. And I think about it a lot, like what did we lose maybe by going back face-to-face and not offering this option anymore?
Yeah, so I hear things about coming up that the sort of trauma-based pedagogy. We really worked with our faculty a lot with that last year, this time, and this empathy in teaching. One of the parts I wonder about is on the other side, on the student side, or for Anne on your visitor side, do we see any changes during the pandemic in terms of the quality of student work, you know, I think you would presuppose that it would be a little worse with all the stresses and all of that. And then as educators, we're a little more, you know, in that empathetic mode, a little more forgiving of what we see. But I'm just wondering, I sort of throw that out. Everybody just, you know, you can unmute yourselves and talk like we're in a room together.
And also Erin joined us. She's another one of the video presenters. I think
your hey, Erin
is next week, but she might pop into and ask you some questions, but I didn't want to leave her hanging.
Awesome. So let's talk about students for just a few minutes. So Jessica, I'll throw it out to you because you're in the upper right of my screen.
Well, I have seen students be more appreciative of the flexibility and of the assignments with different modalities and offering more choice. A lot of students are very grateful to have choice and to, even if they don't need to use the flexibility, to know that it's there, to know that I'm a little more understanding, and that instead of, like Peter was talking about, instead of having that, you know, hard deadline that we've had forever and ever, being a little more flexible. And that, I think,
so you see it shine back from the students a little bit, like,
yeah.
Does everybody kind of feeling that a little bit? Yeah, that's a good thing.
Yeah. So as far as student work, I've seen students are definitely more reflective in my courses. Even I had, you know, reflections built into these teacher education courses, but I've seen students be willing to share their reflections more, and really it appears they are putting a little more thought into them and not just, it's not just the mundane, I need to do this to turn it in.
Yeah, I'm seeing the same thing, but I can't quite understand it yet. Erin, what do you got on this?
Yeah, just to kind of springboard off of that, one thing I've tried to leverage more in like the coursework or assignments I'm designing is I'm finding my students want to connect more. And I think if you can establish an authentic audience for the work, so it's not just, you know, I'm doing this thing for compliance so Dr. Gearhart can see it, but others can see it, it feels more authentic, and we have more connections with others, something that I think we missed out on a lot last year. So like some of the work I mentioned before, like the podcasting work or the art gallery work, publishing, I have them design web quests for elementary science learners, and they publish those on Google sites and peer review them. Some of them have taken those and used them in the field. So just having an authentic audience and knowing, like, you know, we're doing this important work together, it's going to have people actually taking a look at it. It's more meaningful to me. I think just that fulfilling that maybe need for connection and community around the work we're doing in teacher education, I think that's been helpful and definitely something I'm going to take with me into the new as
yeah. It'll be neat to see how that fleshes out again over 10 years, right?
Right.
That do we spiral to a better place because of that? Amanda, what do you think on this student work?
Yeah, I mean, like, I feel like our students are just incredible. They are, like, they had a pandemic thrown at them, and like, I don't know how they do it, honestly, because I know, like, you know, however bad it was for us, it was probably 10 times worse for them. So like, I'm just always so impressed by like the quality of the work that they hand in. You can tell that they're really giving it like a genuine effort. And they're there because they want to learn, and they're willing to put in the time. And so I do have some reflections. I have my my linear algebra students give me a reflection every week. And it's like, it's amazing. They're so open. They're so honest. Like, they're not afraid to tell you like, oh, I have this going on, or like, here's how I feel about things this week. And like, it's so nice that they have like, they were able to build that trust with each other, and like they're willing to put themselves out there, right? Because like, I can see it being intimidating, like you're kind of talking to your prof almost like one-on-one, and
yeah,
but they're so willing to like make that leap, which I find is just really awesome.
And how's that in your world, like in the enthusiasm?
Yeah, well, just two thoughts. I mean, one is that, I mean, we haven't worked with a whole lot of student groups. I mean, and so we look forward to that, but we have worked with small family groups. Mm. And beginning last summer, we were able to open the aquarium to small groups of people that all knew each other and were all masked and all that sort of stuff. And we really, we really enjoy being able to teach on a small scale. And I think the folks who came and did what we called aquarium by appointment were so appreciative of having an opportunity to just connect and connect about, you know, around cool animals and cool science facts and stuff like that. So that's one thought. And then the second thought is that I have a college student as a son, and he's a junior at Georgia. And I am so appreciative of the folks who are on this call who have committed to helping undergraduate students and folks in college and graduate school to be successful. And I have to, you know, share with you the joy that my son felt in being able to reconnect after that crazy spring semester where everybody was sent back, and that his professors now are doing some of the things that y'all are describing to me, and where, you know, professors in even in upperclassmen courses are very busy and they're not always approachable, or it's, you know, never convenient, have been, the access to them has been unprecedented. And I think as a college student, that's been a real silver lining in this pandemic piece. And so I'm grateful to all of you who've given that thought and your energy.
There's one thing, just following up on this, so I agree with Amanda's comments, everybody's comments, really, that the quality of student interaction in many cases has gone up. We use a lot of discussion boards, and the activity on the discussion boards is vastly superior to what it was mm-hmm. when we had in-class activities. Now, maybe we have a biased sample here because we're from a math faculty, so there is a personality trait.
Yes, and so we have math and science represented today, it looks like. You know, I was a classics major as an undergrad, instructional designer, master's, and then recreation and leisure. What do we learn from our hobbies as a as a PhD? So again, I'm the odd man out in this group for sure.
And I think that makes a difference, because in math, I think the students would be more open to sharing in a sort of virtual environment where, I don't know, they feel safer, maybe. But I think there is a group of students that this is not true, that they really need that actual personal human connection. And I worry what we're doing is doing, we have something that works really well for 85% of our students, but is catastrophic for 15%. And we just say, oh, look what happened to the average. It went up. We must be successful. But I kind of worry that there are some students that are being seriously disadvantaged because of the, we're sort of replacing what used to be that human contact. We're in a room, we go for coffee, we chat in the hall, the end of class, throw all that out and replace it with these virtual things that seem to be working so well.
Right.
Only because they work really well for the average.
I would say, Peter, I think that's so important, Peter, that what I usually refer to those as the serendipitous moments of instruction, right? The before class, the students come in, or after class, you know, who's sort of lingering about. And I feel like we miss out on a lot of that. And in fact, even that issue about faculty connecting with one another, you know, we truncated that as well. But what I also heard in all of this, and you know, is it teased out, is a sort of thirst for some more more interaction, and maybe it feels a little bit more meaningful when we get it now, or we're discerning it differently. Certainly, some things have changed a little bit in all of this, and I think some people have retreated a little more, and I hope we can pull them back out. But other people, like I'm hearing these stories, really have sort of blossomed coming, you know, because we were forced to do this. But we even if we thought about it differently, we all sort of lived through it together. I mean, and so there's something important in there.
It's interesting too that you say that, because, you know, I think that's super important. And that was something I really liked about hybrid. You know, I think, yeah, it put more strain on me as an instructor. I almost had to double plan. But also it allowed, you know, in your classes, there's kind of this divide in general. Like, there's the people who are there. Like, I have elementary people that want to teach elementary school, but don't really want to teach science in my class. I'll have middle grades that science their second subject. So they'll teach science if they don't get a math job. And so, like, they kind of want to participate online. Or, you know, people in our program who are teachers, they would much rather have an asynchronous module so they can get the content they need, but they can focus on where their passions are. But then you have those students that crave being there. And so I was talking about those relationships earlier. The ones that came to class, they had a space where they were also with very similar peers. So in a way, the people who wanted to be on the fringe were allowed to be there virtually. And the people that wanted to be in the midst of it, they were able to come in. And so, you know, that was something that I really liked too. I felt like it helped meet the needs of both students, maybe not very well because I had to divide my attention, but I think that might have been better than choosing a mode, like a modality of instruction that would have left out some people.
And what Kayla's really describing is the textbook version of high flex. But what we actually, when we were told at the University of Georgia to go to high flex, it really wasn't high flex. It was about flexibility for the student. But in a high flex model, you're really looking at the flexibility, not only for the student and the instructor, but institutional flexibility. And unless you can kind of get that full triangle, it's just not gonna happen. So, but I think we're gonna learn how to get there better, you know, to see the way a student wants to be a student and how do you meet them and those needs a little bit better. It's an exciting time. This has been scary and worrisome and annoying in so many ways, but I really appreciate all of you meeting with us and sort of trying to tease out what's the good, what are the threads we want to keep pulling on, because I think if we work hard to find those threads, whether we go back to the normal or a new normal or a new, you know, there's a lot for us as individuals and I think as groups and as institutions to learn from this. I mean, we were getting stuck in a rut. That's what I guess I'm saying is education broadly was kind of in a rut and I'm hoping this shook us out of the rut a little bit. I told y'all I'm an optimist. That's my way.
Did anyone have anything they wanted to add or ask each other?
Well, I was wondering just across the board, do you find that your colleagues, the emerging teachers, the training, the teachers in training are hopeful about their choice of a professional field?
Don't be shy.
I feel like that's a loaded question.
I can stop the recording.
you're not being assessed, Jessica.
Students in my program, at least, are hopeful that they will be able to do what they want to do, that they'll be able to teach without, you know, whatever constraint is set upon them. I have some students that want so badly to be in the classroom. And they're in the classroom, but maybe the teacher they're working with isn't exactly fully recovered from what happened in the pandemic. Because as a classroom teacher right now, there is so much on them. They are exhausted. So I think that our candidates are seeing some of the really good, but they're also seeing some things that they can learn from that maybe aren't the greatest examples. And I think that they're hopeful that it will get better and, you know, we will get back to that that new, whatever that's going to look like. But they just want to be there with the students. They want to make those connections and they want to help them. I hope that answers your question.
To kind of add on to that, I think it's been really inspiring and refreshing that some of the candidates we have here at Columbus State, like, because education was so upended last year, it's like, yes, we still have certain constraints on what we can do and not do in the classroom with students. But on the other hand, things are kind of wide open. Like, you don't have to do the worksheet test model anymore. Like, we saw firsthand last year, we can accomplish education ends in a variety of ways. And so that they have this expanded kind of pedagogical palette to play with, I think
write that down.
That's alliterative is what that palette. Is.
Oh my God. Ding, ding, ding. That was a good line, Darren.
I think that that's like really inspiring to them, that they can be creative in ways that maybe they didn't experience when they were K-12 learners. In my course, we do some reflective storytelling about what was it like when you were a student. Jessica did the same thing with their middle grade students this semester. And like, well, you know what? Being a science student kind of sucked when I was a kid. Here's why. And here's what I want to do differently within the context of my own work now. And so I guess all that is to say that I think it's may help them see that they can be more creative. And I think there's a certain professional fulfillment from that. Mm-hmm. If there's anything good we can take from this.
How about from our friends up north?
I was just thinking about your expanded pedagogical palette. The one thing I'm going to remember that. I'm going to use that line.
You steal it, Peter. It's for everybody.
But actually, the one good thing that came out of this is it did allow for experimentation, because I think if things failed, no one felt as badly about
that. That's right.
You know, like when before everything was sort of working. So if you tried something new and it failed, it's like, what are you doing? This was working before. Why are you trying something new? But now it's like, I'm going to try this. I'm going to try that. And I did this myself and lots of other people did. That is something I hope we can continue to leverage, to take advantage of what we've done and keep that momentum. Because there certainly were lots of people excited to trying new things, and they would come. We have our group meetings, our seminars, and say, hey, I tried this, I tried that.
It's a nice bookend, because at first we talked a little bit about students having that ability to fail. But I like how we flipped this script and said, you know, we get some of that too. And that's wonderful. That's wonderful.
And I will say something that made me think of. When we did our coding design project, I basically brought in some Legos for my teacher candidates and said, all right, I want you to build something. And they all looked at me like I was crazy, because they've never been taught like that. They've never just kind of been let loose. Yeah. So that forced me to have to take a step back and scaffold to, okay, this is the end, what I want. Here's how we're going to get there. So I think this whole pandemic is allowing us to take this generation of learners that weren't exactly taught in the most creative way. They were very much, here's your test, here's your standardized assessment, okay, move on to the next grade, and allowing them to explore the creativity and more of the 21st century skills that they're going to be required to teach their students. So I think it's helping in that way too.
That's great. Wow. Well, we're getting close to the, go ahead, please.
If you have one of the things that I experienced in spring 20 when I recorded that video was like, we have a system of reviewing the course material before publishing. In our unit, we have DAG review. And if some of us are building the course content, the others are reviewing, providing feedback. But we simply didn't have time for that during the spring. So we just told students that these are not peer reviewed. You will find typos in there. So we need your help to make this better for the next semester. And students were incredibly cooperative. Like, they were really sending out friendly messages, no judgment. We're all in this together. We're just going to take this textbook and we're going to make it better for your friends who are taking this course next semester. And it was a very rewarding experience. And that student review has actually become one of our, you know, like a part of our review system now. We want students to review the course material before we publish it. And it was very student center, and students' voice was there while we were doing all this, and it was an incredible experience.
It's really exciting.
Don't you give away, sorry, don't you give away bonus marks for finding typos? I think one of you did.
I didn't.
I've been, it reminds me, so this came up a couple of times too, the meaningfulness of the assignment or not. I think it was Aaron, what I call the throwaway assignment, right? Write this paper and then at the end of this, I'll grade it and give you feedback. And at the end, you just throw it away. And so in really thinking about that problem, I've been trying to develop a new pedagogy I call legacy pedagogy. And that's where we have a project in a class and the students develop it and they know that that project will then be handed to the next group of students that are in my class. And they take such a point of pride in doing it. They want to give something to the next students that's good, that they're proud of. And then those students take that project and refine it more. And again, it gets passed and passed. And for me as an instructor, what's been so powerful in that is it really keeps me excited about teaching that class because I'm seeing something grow through time. And so when you talk about the students actually being reviewers in your system, I think that is brilliant to keep building that in. In fact, you may even want to put some mistakes in by on purpose. So that they find them, but maybe there's a way that they get a little initial or something that again, this is something, you know, generative that's moving forward all the time and getting better. I'm really finding a lot of success with that. I have faculty who are working in it in a lot of different domains, from social studies to science to foreign language. And so, you know, please, along with your new palette, your pedagogical palette, please add that one as one small color to your palette. Well, again, I just want to thank you guys all. This is, for me, I'm a pretty upbeat person. And I will say I had some down moments during this whole time of just being kind of isolated. But it's so worth it to do this with you. It re-inspires me and re-engages me in it all. And I can't thank you enough. I do hope you can make it to our conference next year. Kayla will certainly, we'll send out a number of things and let you know what's going on with that. I have one last little announcement that's kind of special for today because we have math and science educators in this group primarily. And you might've heard a bit pinging. My watch was going off. I'm a big space enthusiast and all of my friends started sending me messages that one of our favorite Canadians, William Shatner, is safely in space. So, you know, I'll show my nerdiness. And but again, thank y'all so much for joining us today and keep doing the great work you're doing.